Life is rough.
You gotta take the time to focus on what brings you joy.
As the Japanese say, ikigai.
Or, what am I nerding out about right now?
Join us at the gaming table.
Or reading nook.
To find your happiness.
I'm Laney.
I'm Marshall. And this is Elated Geek. Hello, everyone.
Hello, and welcome to our August book wrap-up. This month is a little weird for a lot of reasons.
It is a very weird month.
Yes. Yeah. I'm Laney.
I'm Marshall.
We're basically just going to talk about a lot of books today. I will tell you that one of the things that has dictated our weird month is that I had a lot of rehearsal because I was in a couple performances, and therefore it let me read different things than I would normally read. I also was in a lot of challenges. We will talk about that a lot. And then Marshall just had a weird month.
I was working on a really big project coming up. I mean, I'm not going to tell you too much about it, but I am writing a book of my own. In fact, I've pretty much been writing it since I graduated from high school, I think. So it's been a long time coming, but this month we were really working hard on it.
Right.
So my brain did not really want to get into other people's books.
I think my problem too is when I'm stressed, I tend to read a lot more to help me cope with the stress. And this month was
super stress.
Very stressful. So why don't we start with Marshall? You'll see why we're starting with Marshall on this one.
I'm going to tell you, first off, when we come to levels, I did level up this month.
Oh, wow.
Yes. So I went from being a level 22 to level 23. However, that's from one book. It was an audiobook, and it is a horror audiobook that was 530 pages long. And that's all I did this month. That's it. I attempted two other books. Mm-hmm. And neither of them would hold me. I attempted Falling by T.J. Newman and One of Us is Lying. I cannot remember who that was by.
It's but by it's the Karen same McManus.
There you go. She also did The Cousins. Uh-huh. I don't think that the reason I couldn't listen to these books was because they were poorly written. I think they were probably very well written. But my brain was like, no, we're in this universe. Laney, what you got?
Well, on the flip side, I have one of the highest book levels that I've had this year. So I read 25 books this month.
Ooh, you go with your bad self.
Giving me a total of 150 books for the year so far, which that means obviously I've surpassed my goal of 104. My second goal usually is 208, so like two times that. So I really only have to read like 58 more books before I get there. You know, and I have, what, four months to do it in? Doable, right? Okay.
Yeah, you read like 13, 14 books a month. You're good.
Which is my minimum, usually, so I think we're good. As far as pages, though, I read the highest amount of pages I've read all year, which is 9,395 pages, giving me a grand total for the year of 51,330 pages, which brings me to level 27.
That's right. Despite this being your highest number of pages in a month, you still only went up one level.
Yeah, exactly.
And yet, this is probably the lowest number of pages I've read in a month, and I also went up a level.
Right. I will talk about stars. The book that you did finish, though, you gave it how many stars?
5 stars.
Yeah, so it was, like, solid. You liked it.
Ooh, yeah.
I remember, though, and we'll talk about this later, but I remember you telling me that it was hard for you to kind of, like, get into the book, but then once you did get into it, it was there. You loved
it. Yes.
Okay.
I did.
So for me, for stars, I was like really, I don't know. I was giving a lot of half stars this month, which I rarely do, but this month I just was. So I have 3 5-star books. I have 5 4.5 stars. So technically, I kind of count the 4.5 into the 5 category because it's like just almost bare, which means I have like 8 books that I was like, these are great. I have 8 more 4-star books. 3 3.5-star books, 4 3-star books, 1 2-star book, which you know I never give 2 stars, like ever, okay? And then I had 5 that I did not finish because I just could not do it. As far as categories go, I had 17 adult books and 8 middle grade or young adult type books. 7 of those were thriller, horror, or mystery books. 5 of them were fantasy, 7 were contemporary or a contemporary romance type book, 4 nonfiction, and 1 historical fiction. 5 of them were physical books, 5 of them were audiobooks, 13 of them were ebooks, and I have a new category now because there is like a way I have discovered I really like listening to the books and reading the books at the same time. So it's kind of like a hybrid, either physical audio or ebook audio, and I did 2 of those. And I'm starting to do that a lot more, especially with books that I get from, like, Book of the Month, where I will get it from, like, Libby on the library, and I'll listen to it as I'm reading it. And I feel like, for me, as someone who is a hearing-impaired person, it's like having subtitles for your books, right? So I think it's perfect. It's, like, the perfect way for me to really understand the book better than just listening to it.
And I can imagine that since both your ears and your eyes are engaged in the book at the same time, it kind of would lead to a more immersive experience because now your eyes aren't dealing with the rest of the world. There's not like, I guess you say like a VR dissonance.
Right, absolutely.
In your reading.
Although I can't do this all the time because I get a lot of like ebooks or ARCs, things ahead of publication. So I can't technically always do this. But when I have the opportunity, I choose to do it this way. And lastly, let me tell you where I got these books. I got 7 of them from the library this month. 12 of them were from NetGalley or Edelweiss or a publisher sent them to me. 7 of them were things I had purchased myself or I had been gifted or I got them in a swap a different way. 1 of them was Libro and 1 of them was Book of the Month. Before I go into the book reviews themselves, I want to talk a little bit about why my books count was so high and why this was a little bit random. So personally, I like to challenge myself to get rid of books that I have in my collection so that I can pare down, especially my physical books. So in that case, I am doing actually 2 kind of challenges. One of them is called the Reading to Zero Challenge. It's by Jackie Wheeler. And I think there's a Facebook group for it if you want to look for it. But basically what it's doing is you say, I have 50 physical books on my shelf, and my goal is to get it down to 0 by next December. So you have like a year and a half, less than a year and a half, to get it done. So that is on my priority. In this month, I actually went through 6 of my physical books, which is great. And then on top of that, I am making it a goal to get through all of my Book of the Month books because those are the ones that tend to be more the ones I have physically anyway, and as well as Libro. I am an affiliate with Libro, and therefore I do get free books every month to listen to, and I have a lot on there that I haven't attempted to listen to yet, so that's another goal of mine, is to try to really pare that down when I have the opportunity to listen to audiobooks, is to pick something that I already have. But yeah, so that's one of the things. And then the very last thing I did this month was in the book club I'm in, we did this whole like Jeopardy reading TBR challenge, okay? And the prompts for this challenge this month were so weird that I had to pick books that I literally never heard of or thought about reading. And then there were some that I was able to choose ones that I had but hadn't read yet, but we'll talk about all those. But that is another reason why some of these books you're gonna be like, what? Bizarre. Let's start. The first book I have is Defy the Night by Brigid Kemmerer. I did receive this from the publisher ahead of publication. It comes out on the 14th of September. So it comes out pretty close here. Brigid Kemmerer wrote the series, the Cursebreakers series. And so I really love that series a lot. And I was interested in trying this. I'm actually on her street team. So, you know, I promote her stuff anyway. But this was the first book I read this month. And I loved it. So Defy the Night is the story of 2 kind of like rogue peasants, I guess is the best way to describe them. Their country is dying, and the only way that they can save the country is to have these like flower petals that you can grind up into an elixir to save them. But there's a shortage, and it is really controlled by the king and his advisors in the castle, as well as the people who rule over the outlying sectors of the country.
So they're dying literally.
There's a disease.
Okay.
Correct. And so they are kind of, I mean, it's kind of Robin Hood-esque, but they're not really robbing for money. They're robbing to save people. So they will like break into the castle, grab the stuff, and then they will make the elixir and pass it out to people who are sick. There's always the threat of getting caught, and they do. They end up going to the castle and meeting the king and his advisors and the people who are in charge of the country. And it just kind of rolls out from there. How do they save their country? This book had quite a few unexpected twists. Some I saw coming, some I did not. And I fell in love with the characters so much. Like, when I was reading Cursebreakers, there were always a couple characters that I was like, why? I just did not really enjoy reading about them. Even though they were really good characters, they just, I don't know, they kind of annoyed me a little bit. But in this book, everyone was solid. And it is a series, and there will be more, and I am so excited to read more. It was like the minute I stopped reading this book, I was like, where's the next one? I need it now. it was great.
Yes. That is going on my list.
I gave it 5. The next book I read this month was Luck of the Titanic by Stacy, Leigh. This is a historical fiction about a girl who is of Chinese descent. She goes onto the Titanic to find her brother who is working as a coalsman in the Titanic. And as we all know what happens on the Titanic.
Yeah. It makes it to the end.
Yeah, sure. So she and her brother were like acrobats in another life, I guess you could call it. I mean, when they were together before he ran off. And so they do like little acts on the Titanic as well. So this was a really interesting book because it kind of tackled racism at the time, especially with Asian people, because we all know, you know, they were put in camps when they, like, you know, when they came to the United States, it was bad, right? Okay, we know this. And so it's even like even doubly tragic that they're on the Titanic. Like, do they survive? Do they not? We know people did survive on the Titanic, but I'm not going to tell you. Like I said, it was a really interesting book. If you like historical fiction, you'll probably like this one. I gave it 4 stars. Would I read it again? Probably not. But it was a good time. I believe I listened to this too, which was a good choice. So
I think especially in modern day when you're dealing with a lot of the problems of like Stop Asian Hate that came out of the COVID pandemic, I think this is a rather good book to have come out in this time.
The third book I read is called The Family Plot by Megan Collins. I did receive this as an advance read from NetGalley. The Family Plot is about a family that lives in like this remote island, but all the kids left the island and the only people who live there are the mom and the dad. And then the dad leaves. There's a lot of drama that is going on in this family. Lots of secrets, lots of twisty little lies. And when she returns, she's trying to figure out who killed her twin brother, or actually, is he dead? Did he disappear? Where has he been? She has spent most of her life trying to find him. So when they find an axe that her brother used to have buried in the plot with her dad, they also find her brother in the plot dead.
Okay.
So now they're trying to figure out what happened. And the story unfolds. It is a very interesting story. Even thinking back on it, I am a little bit chilled when you find out the ending about what really happened, and a little bit disgusted. But I think my one problem with this book was that I didn't connect with the main character very well. I thought she was kind of like whiny. She missed things in front of her that were like glaringly obvious clues as to what was going on with her. I just wanted her to be a stronger main character than she was. I felt that would have floated the story a lot more. She had flaws, and I think she could have still had flaws, but she did not seem to me to be as strong as she should have been going through this, or even growing to be as strong as she should have been. I don't think her growth arc was that great in the book either.
Given what you're saying about this, like, the plot seemed pretty interesting, but now when you describe that main character, I am probably going to avoid this book. Just because every other time I've had a whiny main character, they just made me want to drop the book.
Right. You're kind of particular like that. I mean, I gave it 3.5 stars and I still do recommend it, but I had just some issues with it as well.
Okay.
Yeah. The fourth book I read this month is Me by Elton John. It's his biography, okay. Autobiography. He wrote it. I did listen to the audiobook. It's narrated by Taron Egerton, who played him in Rocketman.
Okay.
So he's familiar.
he knows who he's talking about.
Right. I didn't even know this book existed, but then it came up that I had to read it for this Jeopardy challenge, and I was like, okay, it's pretty long, which is weird to me considering that the book itself is only like 300 pages, 370 pages, but the audiobook is super long. I don't know why of the differential. I really like this book. I thought it was very insightful. If you have seen Rocketman, you will see that there are a lot of things that do correspond, obviously. I gave it 4 stars. I'm not going to talk a lot about it because, you know, it's a nonfiction and you should definitely go read it if you have any interest in Elton John at all.
Okay.
Book number 5 is Never Saw You Coming by Erin Hahn. It is a young adult contemporary romance book. I got this as a review copy because I had read other Erin Hahn books. I also follow Erin Hahn on Instagram, and when I had seen what this book was about, I almost lost it. This is a book about a girl who grew up in a conservative Christian house. She always tried not to do things that the quote-unquote church taught her was wrong, aka revealing too much skin, getting a tattoo, all of that. Her dad leaves her and her mom. So she decides she's going to go move because she finds out that her dad is not her father. Her dad is her stepfather. And her real dad was a one-night stand her mom had at a Christian youth conference.
Wow.
And her dad had died. I believe it was a car accident. It's not really important to the story. So she's shaken to the core. And instead of going to go work at like a ranch camp, she goes to find out who her father's family is. Also, kind of a strict Christian family. And in doing so, she meets a guy who has basically decided to not be part of the church anymore because his dad used to be a pastor and had an affair, and the church ostracized him for his dad's sins. So these two come together with this whole thing about their faith being shaken. Okay, so now you're listening to this and you're like, well, I'm not really, you know, religious. This book could or could not be for you, but I'm speaking primarily to people who grew up in the church and maybe question what they believe in their heart versus what they've been told.
Mm-hmm.
This book deals with a lot of, is what you're doing perceived to be wrong? Doesn't matter if you're actually committing the sin, but is it perceived to be? I cried so much reading this book because it was almost like she knew me when she was writing this book. And she actually does have a note at the end of it that was like talking about how she got the idea from being a woman's Bible study leader for her youth group. And one mom pulled her aside and said, why aren't you talking about abstinence? Why aren't you talking about this? Why aren't you talking about that? And she's like, well, I don't believe what you're saying in the way you're saying it is correct. I think this is a guilt trip. I think this is something that causes people to doubt the love that the church is supposed to be speaking of. And so this book is basically everything she wanted to say to this youth group.
Mm-hmm.
And I cannot believe that someone who's in my 40s feels these same things that someone who is in their 20s is feeling.
Yeah.
About what they were told. And how, to me, and I'm sorry if I'm getting into something like really heavy here, but like to me, you know, my inability to wear certain clothing.
Even at this point in your
life. Even at this point in my life, in my 40s, to step back and say, you know, should I wear this? What are people going to think of me if I wear this? It's still really, like, there. You know what I mean? But yeah, so this book does deal with a lot about sex, premarital sex. It's not a graphic book. There is no graphic sex in this book at all, okay? But there is discussions about it, about how it is perceived, among many other things. But the basic truth of this is that should people who call themselves Christians be so focused on what you shouldn't do and more focused on acceptance and love? Okay. I gave this book 4.5 stars. There was a couple things in the book that felt like the adults weren't as complex as the kids were, but the adults were still very much a part of the story. So I felt like they should have been a little bit more complex in their motives. But other than that, it's a fantastic book. Fantastic book.
Yeah. I might have some difficulty reading it just for the fact that as I'll read it, I am probably going to end up going through a bunch of rabbit holes.
Right.
Being like, well, let me find out what the Bible actually says on that. Okay, well, let me find out what the original Hebrew, I will probably take forever to read that book if I read it.
Right. I believe it. And now for something completely different, let's talk about All the Missing Girls by Megan Miranda. I am in a really big Megan Miranda backlist right now. I got a bunch of books on paperback swap and through swaps with other people, so I'm starting to read more of those. I did read the new book that just came out from her, which is called Such a Quiet Place. But this book in particular is about, guess what, a missing girl. And so it's told like kind of in different points of view. There were times when you saw things happening in the past that leads to when she disappeared. But then things happened in the future where someone else goes missing as well. And they're like, oh my gosh, someone else is missing. So they're trying to see if it's connected. And it really does kind of like, it rolls. But what I will tell you is this book is written very strangely. So when you start the book, you start at day 14. It's like the name of the chapter, day 14. And then it works its way backwards and then forwards and then backwards again. So if you're not paying attention, I felt like I needed to be taking notes while I was reading this book, quite honestly, because you'll find things out at the beginning of the book, but those things happened on like day 14. But then like as you start getting to day one or two, the answers are coming out that she knew in day one, but then there were things that were happening in day 14 that if you didn't have the day one information, it became a shocking twist. But if you had started it in day one, it would have been just like, oh, this is an interesting story. You know what I mean?
Okay.
I really applaud her for taking this risk in like trying something new and trying this whole point of view, you know, way of saying the story. But honestly, I just had issues with it. Did I read it all the way through? Sure. My issues was that I had to be actively reading this book and it wasn't no longer enjoyable for me to just be like, I like reading the book. You know what I mean? I felt like I had to go on a treasure hunt of some kind just to figure out how the things went together.
I'm interested in this book. What kind of stars did you give it?
I gave it 3 stars. It was solid. It was a solid book as far as the story goes. It was just the method.
I'm interested in it primarily because I want to see her mechanic of how she
did this. I think that is a reason to read this book, for the mechanic, to see why this is so interesting. But if you're reading it strictly for an enjoyable story aspect, just go into it knowing you're going to have to do some work. The 7th book I read this month is Ninth House by Leigh Bardugo. Now, I had DNF'd this book. When I read it the first time, I actually was listening to it on an audiobook, and I just couldn't. For something about it, I was like, no. And so for the longest time, I had this like complex that I just didn't like Leigh Bardugo because the same thing happened with Six of Crows and Shadow and Bone. And I was like, maybe Leigh Bardugo just isn't for me. But guess what? Good old Jeopardy rears its head again and decides it's going to give me Ninth House. And I'm like, oh, why? Just my luck. So I did something a little different and I got it from the library in ebook form instead. This made all the difference to me because I enjoyed this book so much more this time around. It is the story of a girl who is tapped by the people who oversee the secret societies at Yale. So she and this other guy named Darlington are kind of trained to be the ones to make sure that the secret societies don't get out of control with their magic, with their happenings, and whatever. But she has the added bonus of being able to see ghosts, whereas everyone else in this society can't. They have to take, like, an elixir in order to see it, and it, like, messes with them. But she has this natural ability, which is why she got tapped. And then Darlington goes missing. Mm-hmm. And she's not done with her training yet. She's supposed to get an entire year. So now she's trying to hold it together with all of these societies just doing what they want to do. And she's not exactly sure how to do that. On the flip side, she's trying to find Darlington and figure out what happened to him. Is he coming back? Etc. This was so good. And I'm so glad that I came back to it. I actually gave it 4 stars. I left 1 star off because I had DNF'd it the first time because, I mean, maybe that was the audiobook fault. I don't know. But the mystery is great. It is part of a series. I will be reading the second one. I think it was actually a lot better.
I like Leigh Bardugo. I really like Six of Crows. Shadow and Bone did not get me as much as Six of Crows. Mm-hmm. So I'm willing to give this a shot.
Book 8 is The Taking of Jake Livingston by Ryan Douglas. This is like a YA horror book. I read this because Gabby's Book Troop book club was reading it, and it sounded really interesting to me. It's the story of a boy, again, who can see ghosts. He's part of a family that kind of is a medium kind of family, but his mom and brother can't see ghosts, but I think like his grandmother or grandfather could. And there is a serial killer who shot himself after doing a school shooting. And the serial killer is basically haunting him, almost taunting him, really, to come into his world. And Jake wants to figure out exactly what happened because all of a sudden this ghost kills an actual person. And they're not supposed to be able to do that. I really like the main character, Jake. He's really sympathetic. And he is bullied a lot for being different, which I thought was a really great way to have him portrayed. His abilities are very enjoyable and very interesting, but sometimes it just didn't connect with me in the way it was written. There are definite trigger warnings in this book. I mean, there are a lot of trigger warnings in this book. So as a YA book, you definitely need to go in with caution. There, not only is he bullied, but there are some other things that happen that I feel like could be triggering to people. There is a heavy subject matter in this, but the book is not heavy. The book is actually very light, fun, and campy. So I think that is a really interesting like juxtaposition of this ghost story with heavy topics, but yet the way it's told is not depressive.
One can always approach the paranormal in two different ways. That it is dark, scary, and bad, or that it is part of the real world that just has some dark spots to mm-hmm. it. And if you bring your own light to that dark spot, it might not necessarily be so bad.
Mm-hmm. But I gave this book 4 stars. I thought it was a good time. Book number 9 was a reread that I had read before, but I had to read it for Jeopardy, and it's called I've Got Your Number by Sophie Kinsella. Sophie Kinsella is still one of my favorite authors from my life cycle arc, meaning I have read her the longest, basically. But this book, and I'm not even going to talk about it very much, this book I still didn't like. I didn't like it the first time I read it. I gave it 2 stars, and if you want to know better about it, you can go on Goodreads, but I'm not going to talk about it. Book number 10 is Good Girl, Bad Blood by Holly Jackson. This is the second book in the Good Girl's Guide to Murder series. Marshall is pointing to it over on his desk over there because he is waiting to read this sucker. Mm-hmm. The new one, number 3, comes out at the end of this month.
Nice.
Very anticipating because this book, I gave it 5 stars. The first book, I gave 5 stars. I am in love with this book series. It is about Pip, and she has her little podcasting series. She's still kind of trying to figure out how to recover from everything that happened in the first book with all the murders and who was involved and whatnot. I'm not going to tell you why, because if you haven't read the first book, I don't want to spoil it for you.
Yeah.
But it hurt very close to her. Personally, it was a bad hit. But then, guess what? More things happen. One of her friend's brothers goes missing. And so, against her better judgment, she decides she's going to get involved. There's just more.
There is more.
I'm not even going to talk about it, but it's more podcasting, more detective series, more very cool, strong, amazing, decisive, intuitive Pip that I love.
And that's something that I really like as a transition. Like, in the first book, everything that she was doing for this investigation was part of a report that she was doing for school, her mm-hmm. final thing. And now she's transitioning that into podcasting, which makes total sense for her character.
Right.
Because she's quirky, yet she can be approachable when she needs to be.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, yeah, she makes a great podcaster. This is a good transition to get into being a storyteller.
Now, what else is really fun about all of this is that, you know, if you haven't read the first book, you might be like, okay, well, can I really enjoy this? Well, here's the great part. I will also not spoil this, but the way that they recap the first book in the second book is absolute genius. I cannot wait, Marshall, until you read this book, because you're going to read it and you're going to be like, wow, that is awesome the way they do this. Because it's not like, and this is what you missed. No, it's not like that. It's not. It's so great. So yes, I gave this 5 stars. Highly, highly recommend this book. This book series, just read it.
It's good stuff.
Just read it. Book number 12 is For Your Own Good by Samantha Downing. This has been a very largely anticipated book for me this year. I loved He Started It, My Lovely Wife. These are, you know, thriller books. And so when I saw this one, not only is it thriller, but it's also dark academia. And I kind of like this whole dark academia setting. For Your Own Good is the story of a professor who cares a lot about his students, to the point where he has some kind of like unconventional methods of like getting them on the track of success that he thinks they should be at. And in so doing, I'm not saying he has anything to do with it, but in so doing, some weird things start happening at the school. One of the other teachers might wind up dead in different ways. And this story is actually told in a couple different perspectives. And what I loved about this series, not to mention the twists where I was like, what? What else I loved was that there are characters in this book that you start the book going, oh my gosh, stereotypically, I do not like this character. I think they're going to annoy me. And then you start getting to the end of the book and you start loving what type of character they are and what they're doing. I listened to this book on audio. For me, I think that was my drawback. I really should have read this book physically, and I probably will go back and reread it physically, because I don't think the experience made as much of an impact as it should have. And I finished this in the middle of the month, so it's been a couple weeks since I read this book. And after reflecting, I actually bumped my score up 0.5 star from when I originally rated this. So originally I gave it a 4. I'm now giving it a 4.5. And I do recommend, I think she is a great writer. And if you go into it just really expecting to have a good time about what's happening, you're going to love this book. It's really great.
I really enjoyed He Started It. Mm-hmm. It was good fun, I felt like. Mm-hmm. And it really captured the idea of what was... So I'm really interested in this one. Again, I like to see some darker academia too, because it provides a nice sheltered setting for a mystery.
All right. In the interest of maybe like hurrying through a couple more books here, I'm going to go through these next ones rather quickly.
Okay.
Book number 13 is called After by Anna Todd. I knew nothing about this book going into it. Again, I had to read it for Jeopardy. It was fine. It's like a romance, and they, I think, have made a TV show about it. I don't know. Nothing really stuck with me about this book, honestly. I didn't really like it that much, but it was a solid storytelling, so I gave it 3 stars. If you want to know more about it, you can go look at that up. Number 14 was The House of Earth and Blood. It's the number one in the Crescent City series by Sarah J. Maas. Again, another book I didn't really intend to read, especially because it's long. It's 803 pages. I listened to it. I wasn't really into the story that much. If it's really, really high fantasy, it's a real hit or miss for me. And in this case, I just could not connect to the story itself. I don't want to talk about that much. This is a very mainstream book, so we don't have to go much more than that either. I did give it 3 stars. I also read a couple nonfiction books. So I got the 400 Calorie Mediterranean Diet Cookbook. I gave it 4 stars. It was solid. I also read the unofficial Disney Parks Drink Recipe Book.
Oh yeah, I saw that on the list.
Right. guys, this book was a 5-star for me.
Ooh.
Might be the first time I ever gave a cookbook type recipe book a 5-star review, mainly because not only are the recipes like so cool and creative, and now I know what to order when I go to Disney, but also because there was a lot of like background about why they created the drinks the first place from Disney. And I was like, yeah, this is awesome. So I loved this book. Weird that it's a 5-star, but there you go.
Man, I'm going to now download that onto my Kindle. when I'm done with this comic I'm working on, I'm definitely going to be reading that one.
Right. I also read I Love My Air Fryer Affordable Meals. We're trying to find like more recipes. I know you like probably are like, why are you adding cookbooks? I read them all. But yeah, we're trying to figure out more recipes for our kitchen. We have an Instapot. We have an air fryer. So found a couple in there. Not a lot of recipes, especially not low-carb recipes. I gave it 3 stars. And then one interesting other nonfiction book I read was Home Hydroponics. And this book is about how to turn your home into a place where you can grow a lot of plants and vegetables and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
For us, it's not really the most viable thing because we have cats and they'll probably eat it. This is more like a textbook. There's a lot of technical instructions in here about making these things, you know, how to measure it, what you need for it. So the book itself was highly informative. So I gave it 4 stars, even though I'm probably not really sure like how I'm going to use this book. I really appreciated what was in it.
It's a good book for zombie apocalypse.
Probably. Yes. Yeah. And my next book that I read is called Blanca and Roja. This is by Anna Marie McLamore. This was actually my first Anna Marie McLamore book, and I have been wanting to read more by this author, but she, for whatever reason, just hasn't made her way into my TBR list. And I had this one that I had purchased for like a dollar or two, like for a while. And I finally was like, yes, let's do it. This is the telling of Swan Lake.
Ooh.
They kind of tell the story in like 4 points of views. Blanca, Roja, and then these other 2 boys. And then the story of Blanca and Roja is that they are part of a cursed genealogy where the women in their family will have twin girls, and this group of swans will take one of the girls from the family every generation. And in this generation, they're trying their hardest to not be taken by the swans. I don't know. This book didn't hit me. And okay. I really wanted it to because it sounded really whimsical and beautiful. But for some reason, I just could not get into it. I only gave it 3 stars. But I'm still probably going to read more books by Anna Marie McLamore in the future. Let's continue on to another book I DNF'd previously that I came back to. This is Finlay Donovan is Killing It by Elle Cusomano. When I first read this book, I got about a quarter of the way in and went, oh no, I don't know. I don't know if I was just not in the mood to read it or what. But then people started talking about it again, and I was like, you know what? I'm just going to give it another chance. I'm in the mood for like a mystery book that's kind of fun. Let's see if I can go farther. And oh my gosh, I am so glad I went farther because this story is hysterical. And I will tell you, I've already been approved for the advanced copy of the second one in the series, so I am excited there. Finlay is a murder novelist. She goes to a Panera and sits down with her agent to discuss her book. She's a single mom of 2, and so she's having writer's block. She doesn't know how to finish this book to provide for her family. So she's sitting there having this discussion with her agent, and at the next table over is a woman who overhears her and mistakes her for a contract killer. And at this point, Finlay Donovan needs to kill it.
Mm-hmm.
Him. So the book unfolds. There were times, Marshall will attest, I was reading this book and I started laughing out loud. I was gasping. I was like, oh man, no way. Like this book, was like the best experience.
And seeing it from the outside, it just looks like it's going to be a great book. I want that on my list.
Right.
Because it seems so fun. And it's also this thought that I think a lot of people have had, like, what if Miss Marple is actually a killer? And she's just hiding it by blaming everybody else by being a private investigator.
Right. So what I really want to say about Finlay is that, you know, I wasn't really expecting a lot of things that happened in this book, obviously. And I just love the character of Finlay because she finds herself in these positions that are, like, so horrible. Like, how are you going to pull out of this? But she's resourceful, and somehow things just turn out okay for her, you know? There's the epilogue. Oh my gosh. Read the book for the journey. Stay for the epilogue because, oh my gosh, the epilogue is the thing that made me want to be like, and we're reading the second one, everyone. Reading the second one. I gave it a 4.5 only because I DNF'd it the first time. I let half a star off. If this was my first time reading it, I probably would have given it a full 5 stars. But I didn't. I gave it 4.5.
So you really do, like, you give a half a star off just because there is something in there that keeps it from gripping you the first time.
Correct. Yes. Yes. I know it's not totally fair, but to me, I feel like if I'm coming back to reread it, to give it another go, I need to at least account for that a little bit. So yes, I'm raising it a lot in its value, but still not a perfect book. There was something. My next book is called Aristotle and Dante Discover the Secrets of the Universe. This is by Benjamin Aline Saenz. I believe that's how you say it. This came out, I want to say, in 2012. So it's been out there for a while. There is a second one coming out finally, I guess, next year. Aristotle and Dante is written in a very interesting way. They are definitely flawed characters. Aristotle is a boy who just doesn't know who he is, doesn't know how to express his feelings, is very awkward when his mother tries to love him. His father has some, like, post-traumatic war situation going on, right? So he can't really relate to his son either. Aristotle doesn't think he has very many friends. He thinks he's an outcast. He doesn't really fit in that he knows. He's also a Hispanic kid named Aristotle.
Yeah. How are you even going to do a nickname for Aristotle?
They call him Airy.
Yeah, like,
yeah.
I don't even know if that really feels like it fits.
Right. So then he meets Dante, who has moved to his area. His father is a professor. Dante is also a Hispanic kid named Dante. And they laugh about it because Aristotle and Dante are legitimately, like, what, Greek names? Something like that. Right. Okay. So they become friends. Dante starts to fall in love with Aristotle. And Aristotle's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. I don't go that way, really. Until the day when Aristotle saves Dante from being hit by a car. And their friendship is beautiful. The way this book is written, I didn't really think I was going to like it because it's off-putting sometimes when the characters don't know themselves, but you, the reader, do. But in this case, I feel like the story of their friendship, the story of them discovering who they themselves are, how they're growing in themselves, and when they discover the secrets of the universe, it's not just the universe, it's also that the universe is them, themselves. It was a ridiculously beautiful book, and what I didn't expect to like as much as I did, although there were some parts where the characters, when they would be writing, would be repetitive. Okay. And that is why I did knock it off 1 star. I gave it 4, but it was just a very beautiful book. And I'm interested to see where they're going to go with the next one, which I think it's called Dive Into the Waters or the Deep or something like that.
I'm not sure if I want to read it, but if they come out with a Netflix show or something like that, I would watch that. I would probably watch that straight up.
Just because
I feel like if you're dealing with characters who don't know themselves, yeah, in a book form, I might have some difficulty with that. But in a show, I can deal with it. It's all about the acting.
So stay with us, guys. We're in the end stretches here of the books. Yes. All right. So next book I have is Take Me With You When You Go. This is by David Levithan and Jennifer Niven. I am a part. It hasn't gone up yet. But I did like a little book tour with them. So I did get the book in advance to read. This book is like a YA contemporary and it's told through emails.
Okay.
And it is told between Ezra and B, who are siblings. B is a little older than Ezra, and B runs away. They don't have a very good home life. Their stepfather is abusive. And now they're very mad that B has gone, but no one knows why B has gone. So Ezra starts getting emails from B, finding out that the reason that she has gone has to do with them, their family. They're mad at their mother for not standing up to their stepfather for a lot of reasons. You start to find out more about B's mentality, because a lot of people in her life, like her boyfriend and her best friend, are saying things about her that are not positive. And so Ezra is trying to find out why is what is happening. There's a lot of secrets and mysteries. And when you find out where she goes and why, it is interesting. It's interesting what happens. I don't think that this book was necessarily as deep as it could have gotten for the subject matter. I only gave it 3.5. The first half of the book, I was riveted. I was like, where's this going? What is happening? And I sped through it and I liked it. The second half of the book falls apart a little bit for me. It was kind of more of a pacing issue. It felt like it was dragging a lot more. There was a lot more like thinking and not enough like telling me what's happening. I just got really distracted, but the ending, I think, was very satisfactory. I thought it was a good ending. It was a solid book. Mm-hmm. Not my favorite, but solid.
Okay.
Next book was number 2 in the Nevermore series. It's called Wondersmith. It is The Calling of Morrigan Crow. So as we learned in the first book, Morrigan has powers, and she was trying out to be part of a secret academic society. And now she's there. She's as part of the society. And what's interesting about this book is that she's starting to learn more about her powers and who she is and what she does and why people are so against it. But there is one rule. So there's one, their class, I can't remember how many kids are in their class, but they do everything together. They go they travel from like this magical, it's almost like a magical train station. There's like a door that opens up in all of their bedrooms or their houses, and they immediately can get on the train and go to the train to the educational place.
The Wonderground,
I think. It's kind of a different part of the Wonderground, but okay. Yes. And so they do that together. They take certain classes together, and then they come home together. They have to take, there's like challenges that they do also together, but if one of them fails, they all fail. If anyone outside of their group tells people who Morrigan is, they all will get in trouble. And then this group starts getting blackmailed by, they don't know who, that says, we will tell your secret if you don't do this. And so they are, trying to figure out why that's happening. And people start going missing. I noticed a really big theme in all of my books this month where people go missing.
That seems to be a theme in a lot of books.
That's true.
That's a pretty easy way to get people moving.
True, yeah. So they're also trying to figure out why people are going missing. Solid book, I would say. I gave it 4 stars. I still have one more to go called Hollowpox, which is about people getting sick. And then another one's coming out. What did I say? It's either this month or next month, right? The fourth one is coming out. So these are large books, though, people. This book is 544 pages.
Ooh.
So prepare yourself. I did listen to this on audiobook as well as read it physically, in physical form.
And I like how they're introducing the other classmates. I had heard in that first book, like, this is something that we do in our society. And I was really looking forward to seeing them do that.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't do that at all in the first book, really.
Right.
So seeing them do that a lot more in the second book, I'm like, okay, that's what I want.
Right, exactly.
Mm-hmm.
The next book I read was called The Charm Offensive by Allison Cochrane. This book comes out in a couple days from when we will be posting this, actually. This is a story of a reality dating show. I've been really into these kind of books lately also. It's like, it's either dark academia or reality dating. I don't know. I don't even watch The Bachelor or The Bachelorette, so I don't know where this is coming from.
So if somebody does a reality dating in a dark academia setting and that's the book, would you be like,
there for it.
Yeah.
So in this show, there is a main character, Dev, who is really hung up on love, the fairy tale of love, and has been since he started watching this show. I can't remember what the name of the show is, this reality dating show, when he was like younger. And so he is now a producer on the show, and his job is to wrangle the contestants. Mostly he's assigned to the women when there's a guy. And it's all like Prince Charming themed and whatever. The other funny thing is his ex is also a producer on the show, and then they broke up abruptly. So he's still a little bitter about that. So then you come to find out the guy who's been cast as Prince Charming in the season, who is coming on the show basically to improve his image because he has some social problems. They have a little issues with him. So Dev goes to the guy, whose name is Charlie, and basically starts trying to help him become the Prince Charming that he can see him be. And this book was so great. Yes, it is a male-male romance, so there is that. But the relationship between the two of them was really beautiful. The author writes this book really honestly and allows the characters to go on this journey of finding themselves and rediscovering themselves and embracing who they are, even when they are in their 30s and they're kind of like, well, I never really thought about who I am. Am I gay? Am I asexual? Am I situationally romantic? That kind of thing. And while you're sitting there thinking, well, you know, it's kind of like talking about sex, there isn't a lot of graphic sex in this book, and I fully appreciated that. That you can show and allude to what is happening without being like very graphic. Mm-hmm. And that was a lot to be done in this book. There is an awesome community of people that come together in this book as well, which is one of my favorite things in books. Because of that, I gave this book 4.5 stars. I super fell in love with the characters in this book. There were not hardly any characters that didn't annoy me for the wrong reasons, if that makes sense.
That's kind of one of the things that I have issues with. Like, I can handle romances, but when it comes to, like, the sexual portions of it...
Well, I don't like it in any form, mm-hmm. really. I don't mind that there are sex scenes in books, but I don't like graphic sex scenes, and I don't care who is it. I don't care if it's male, female, what. I just don't like it. I think it jars me out of the experience unless there is a specific reason for it. And maybe this is sad of me to say, but like, if you're trying to depict assault or something, sometimes that's necessary to bring you into the horrificness of the story. If there is no reason to drive the story with the graphicness of it, then I don't think it should be there.
I'm with you on that.
I think it's a mark of a good writer to be able to not do that. I mean, there is a place for people in their erotic literature, and I'm not saying that there isn't, but I'm saying that, like, I just appreciate when people can write it and have the story be great without that. All right, my next book is Instructions for Dancing by Nicola Yoon. This was one of my Book of the Month books that I tried to get through, but I did listen to it on audiobook. It was a very quick read for me, and this was a really cute book. It was about a girl who has a dad. I think her dad ends up leaving her family. That's another familiar trope that I read this month. And she goes to the little free library that's in her neighborhood to drop off some books and finds a book called Instructions for Dancing, and there's an address in the middle part of it. So she ends up going to this ballroom studio at this address to learn how to ballroom dance. But something kind of funky happens to her after she gets this pamphlet. I'm not going to tell you what it is, because even the summary doesn't tell you what it is. But this thing happens, and she now sees things in a completely different way that has to affect love and people in her life and how they love. And because she's dealing with her father leaving her, she doesn't believe in love like she used to, because she's hurt by it. But this journey that she goes on to try to figure out why people fall in love and why they stay in love, or if they even stay in love, is all what she is learning here as she is learning to ballroom dance with a guy named X, the grandson of the people who own the dance studio. Mm-hmm. There is something that happens in the ending of this book that took me completely by surprise. And I can't even talk about it, but it's not a shocking twist, but it is a tragic twist, the way that it is portrayed. And I felt like this book was just... it was really well written, and I really liked reading it, and I thought the way that they used magical situations in this to further the story was quite interesting. I gave it 4.5 stars. Okay. Legitimately, it was interesting. I thought the ending was a little bit too abrupt, though, for how they did it. It didn't give you enough time to process, I think, what happened. So that was that. Okay. Down to the last book, or my last book, folks.
Yeah, you're almost there.
Almost there. It is The Spires by Kate Moretti. I read her book last year called The Girls of Bracken Hill. It's a thriller book. I thought it was really interesting. This book is called The Spires because it's about a group of college roommates who, after college, go to live in a church converted into a huge house. So they call themselves The Spires to be funny. But it's also told in the present where this woman named, they call her Pip, another Pip, okay? Like, what's with all the Pips? And her name is Penelope, really, but her college friend Willa shows up at her house and is like, I left my husband because he was abusive. Can I stay with you? And then Penelope starts realizing that things are going missing in her house, and then they're put back. There's things that aren't quite kosher happening in her house, and she's starting to suspect Willa. Especially because Willa isn't really acting a lot like Willa used to act. So she's trying to get to the bottom of what is going on with Willa. And then you're also being told, you know, that there's a fire. You know the church house has burned at some point and that someone died. So you're being told in, like, backflashes what happened to find out why this person died, who is responsible, and why it burned down. Which is fine. I was not as interested in the back story scenes as I was with what was happening in the present. I felt like a lot of the past chapters were semi-necessary, but not the best, because I didn't get enough clues in these things. I don't know. So I kind of felt like those chapters lagged, but the present one didn't. I ended up giving it 3.5 stars because I liked the book, but I just didn't like all of it.
If you have two different portions, they both need to be equal in the amount of what they do.
Mm-hmm. Marshall, we're down to your last book.
My only book, and that is by Chuck Wendig, The Book of Accidents.
Which I read last month and was my favorite book last month.
And it's worth it.
Mm-hmm.
So The Book of Accidents is the story of a man whose father was not a good guy and is dying of cancer. And the father's like, I really want you to take the family home. And if you don't come and buy it from me for $1... you're just going to inherit it and have to pay all the taxes. Well, they go over there, and once they're moving in, the guy is now seeing, like, the ghosts of his father here. Like, his dad never really left, stuff like that. And his wife, who is a really awesome artist, she starts having these blackouts, and the artwork she makes vanishes. And all sorts of other weird and crazy things happen, and they're all kind of related back to this event that happened back when the main male character was a boy. A serial killer had been put on death row, and according to some sources, when he was electrocuted, he just vanished. And it's trying to figure out how all of these stories kind of collide. When I listened to it, it was done with two different voice actors. One is for the father and the son, and the other one is for the wife. And it all kind of, it really does come together. There's a big story. Even once you figure out what is going on here, that gets you halfway through the story.
Right.
And now you have to deal with, how do they actually complete this? How do they stop what's going on? How do they deal with all of this insanity?
And it's kind of an overwhelming problem to deal with, really.
It is something that no normal person is equipped for.
Right. I will also say, before you go on, that after talking with a bunch of other people who have also read this book, I read this book as an ebook, Marshall did it as an audiobook, and I have heard that people who listen to it as an audiobook find it more difficult to get through for some reason than the people who read it as an ebook. Because when you read the ebook, it's like very short chapters. And so it kind of breaks it up a little bit more. And I think it just feels like it flows a little bit better. It gets you to the place you want to go faster. Whereas in an audiobook, you don't really have that luxury. You have to stay with it in the speed at which you're listening to it. Mm-hmm. And so sometimes it feels like maybe you're not getting there fast enough and it's dragging.
And what they oftentimes did in this audiobook was, if two chapters were from the same viewpoint person in a row, they just didn't break the chapters.
Oh, wow.
So you just kept on going. Even though, like, in the audio tracks, it broke it. Mm-hmm. They never said, well, now we're in a new chapter.
Right.
That is going to add to it. But all in all, I really loved it. It was, like I said, the first book of the month that actually held me.
I think, too, when he was listening to it, he was like, I don't get it, man. Like, I it's just dragging for me. And I was like, you gotta stay with it, though. You gotta stay with it. You will like this book. I know it was exactly the type of book that you go for.
Yes.
So I'm glad it you was. Stuck with it. Yeah.
Yeah. Once you got over this particular hump and the weird started happening,
mm-hmm.
then it took off. Then you got to the halfway point and it was like barreling full speed. You right. couldn't stop it.
It's, right.
If you like weird stories and stories of the weird, mm-hmm. this is a book for you.
So you would obviously say this was your favorite book this month because you only read one.
Mm-hmm.
Well, my favorite book this month was Defy the Night. I could have also put Good Girl Bad Blood, but I really thought Defy the Night was just, it was just so great. And I read so many good books this month. I read so many books this month, but a lot of them were winners and that surprised me a lot. Do you have anything that you are looking forward to reading next month?
Well, right now I am currently going back to Falling. That's, but I'm a good chunk through it, and so I'm going to give it a chance. I also have Eric Larson's No One Goes Alone that I'm going to be trying out,
mm-hmm.
and I am in the middle of reading Teen Titans Beast Boy Loves Raven, which is nice and cute. You do have Defy the Night that I've just added on there, but we've got Good Girl Bad Blood, The Ones We're Meant to Find, and then just a few other small things that I'm holding on to.
I'm currently listening to The Four Winds right now by Kristen Hanna, as well as reading Under the Whispering Door by TJ Klune. Both of those are kind of slow going for me right now, but I'm also going to be trying to read, I'm starting my seasonal fall reads right now as well. So I'm going to be reading Book of Magic by Alice Hoffman,
oh, yeah.
which comes out in October. And I'm really excited for that one, actually. A couple other arcs that I have that are like, you know, spooky themed. I've got Summer Suns and The Last House on Needless Street, which are both scary. And then I also have The Last Graduate, which is the sequel to A Deadly Education by Ooh. Naomi Novik. So I'm also reading that one probably this month. I don't know what else I'm reading, to be honest. I did not plan this month yet because I was just like, I don't know.
What's going to be left over?
I don't. I mean, I have a ton I can still read, but I just don't have the mental capacity to plan it out. So it's really going to be like, what do I feel like reading right now type thing.
Okay.
Also 56 Days. That's the book troop book for this month. I just got it. I have it in Book of the Month, but I'm getting it from the library to listen to as well.
Okay.
So that is our book, and I'm really sorry. It was long. I'm sorry. But that was our August book wrap-up. And, of course, you can find me on TikTok and Instagram Reels at Zany Laney. And on my Instagram feed, I do review all of these books, too, in different ways. So you can go on there and check out if you are wondering about other books that I do as well.
So thank you for listening to Elated Geek. Follow us on social media for pictures and more info on things we talked about in today's podcast. You can find Laney on at Zany Laney or me at One True Hazard. You can also find at Elated Geek on our Instagram. And you can also find Elated Geek Tweets on Twitter. If you want to go to a website, we have www.elatedgeek.com. Links for these are in the show notes.
If you want to help us to continue to bring you new and exciting things to nerd out about, please consider donating to our Ko-fi account. The link is in the show notes, and every donation is accepted with total appreciation for your support in us.
Send us your geek obsessions or topics that you want us to experience and talk about in future episodes. Email us at share@elatedgeek.com.
And until next time,
geek out.